So hello once again. This is the last full day of this retreat, alive, aware, awake, on the four foundations of mindfulness. So I'm aware that we've covered a lot of ground over these last few days, and at the same time we've also barely scratched the surface. Mindfulness or awareness, we've been using those two words interchangeably, is not something that you ever get to the end of. There is always more. There's always more. And when the Buddha taught the foundations of mindfulness, he said he taught them for experienced practitioners, those who had already traveled a long way along the path of spiritual practice. And he also said that he taught them for beginners. So he's saying this practice, these four foundations, are suitable for anyone and everyone. In a way, they are practices for all people and for all times, for every moment of our days, every moment of our lives, whatever we're doing, whether we're working, being at home, part of family life, whether we're meditating or walking, whether we think we're practicing or not. They are relevant to all of us. And in a way, so we're not really just talking about a practice that we do so much as a mode of being, or even a way of living. Mindfulness or awareness as a way of living in the world. And the Buddha also taught that, an enlightened or an awakened being would also practice. He did practice these four foundations of mindfulness, not because he needed to practice, but because they are a natural expression of the awakened mind. So they're both a practice and also a fruit. Yeah, what you naturally do when the mind is awake. And when we start off practicing, it can feel like there's quite a lot to be done. There's quite a lot to be done, which is true. But in Living with Awareness, Sangha Rachta says something quite encouraging. He says, as you go on, mindfulness demands progressively less effort. In contrast to the slow and painful process it's sometimes made out to be, you find yourself treading a path of ever-growing clarity and delight. So I find that quite encouraging. So as we've been exploring mindfulness or awareness, we've encountered that it has a number of qualities. In a way, it's very simple, and in a way, it's quite mysterious. It's quite hard to pin down. Perhaps one of the main qualities is this quality of presence, of simply being here in this moment. So bringing yourself fully to this moment. But there's also a quality of remembering, in other words, remembering to be present, as a practice. And there's something quite purposeful or deliberate about this practice of mindfulness or awareness, You're choosing to do it, and you know why you're choosing to do it. And it also has a quality of vigilance or heedfulness or discernment even. There's an ethical dimension to mindfulness where you are taking care You're taking care of states of mind, and you're taking responsibility for what you are, how you are, and what you become, and its effect on others. So perhaps returning to this sense of the remembering aspect of awareness or mindfulness, we can just revisit these four foundations, which are, we've been talking of them more as gateways, as ways into awareness. And Hridayagita introduced us to the body, and she described it as this, what was beyond the conceptual, non-conceptual, but also knowing. So the body has its own knowing, but it doesn't necessarily arise as idea. And everything is felt in the body, thoughts and emotions, all felt in the body. And what's really helpful about the body as a gateway is that it immediately, it's very immediate, it's always right there, it's right there. And also it grounds, we tend to need to come down into the body, so it connects us, it earths us. And when we disembody, we tend to sort of go up and forwards often. So the body can be a coming back and a downwards. And Hridayagita talked about the body as a box of delights. So this is a positive way of relating to the body, a positive story about the body. It's a box of delights, yeah. There's all sorts of goodies in there. So this, we can have a sense of curiosity and play. And then the foundation or the gateway of Vedana or feeling, this very simple, pleasant, painful or neutral, a sort of knowing of what, which of those three, any experiences. Maitri Siddhi brought in this idea of the emoticons, yeah, it's just very straightforward. And I think that's what the feeling tone offers us. It offers us a simplicity. So how to, when things feel very complex, we can just come back to that simple question. Is it pleasant or painful? And to that simple question, and there's also maybe a simple response to the answer. If it's painful, we just need to bring some kindness to sit alongside that pain with tenderness. And if it's pleasant, then we can appreciate it. And it's of the nature of if we notice pleasure, then pleasure grows. It's of that nature. So what we attend to tends to increase, tends to flourish. So this is an important part of meditation practice, particularly with the dhyanas, is to dwell, knowing and appreciating pleasure, and it grows of its own accord. And something else that Maitri Siddhi explained with Vedana is that when we tend to block pain, we tend to also block pleasure. So it's as if pain and pleasure are on one big spectrum. If you lop off one end, you tend to lop off the other. And that means our experience tends to be a bit narrow and less colourful, less rich. So that was a very interesting gateway that we can bring awareness to. The third one was, of course, citta, the heart mind. So this, just having a sense, first of all, that emotions and thoughts are deeply interconnected. They rise together, even if we experience them in different locations, and we tend to always experience them in the body. And they had a more passive dimension to them, what simply arises into our experience, what we might think of as our subjective experience. And then also an active dimension where we have a choice about how we respond to what's arisen for us. And this is a really important part of citta is this, it brings in this element of discernment. Yeah. Is what's arising, how am I responding to it? What qualities of my mind are there? Are they qualities of grasping, pushing away, turning away or ignoring? Or are they qualities of contentment and love and clarity and honesty? And if we find ourselves with those grasping, pushing away and ignoring, then they tend to be experienced as tension and tightening in the body. They tend to set up stories that are circular, repetitive, and tighten and diminish us, you know, almost vicious circles. So this is the reactive mind. It's an agitated mind, yeah. It's disturbed in various ways. But the mind that is undisturbed, that is more of its natural state, has qualities of love, contentment, clarity, and these will lead to perspectives and narratives that allow, that open, that in a way give out onto possibilities. And these different ways of responding to our experience with a reactive or a creative response, they'll determine how we are experienced now, and they can increase pain massively or reduce it. But they also determine how we will experience things in the future, in a way the person that will become, the habits we develop. And then finally with citta, we were just looking at how to work with what's arising at the moment, and this sense of the need for perspective, and particularly when you're in it, you feel like you're in the story, in the emotion, in the disturbance. You need to step back out of it, give yourself a bit of perspective. And if you feel that you're somehow a bit distant from it, you need to come closer. So we're always playing with these two modes of intimacy and perspective, what's needed. And then when we looked at the fourth foundation, which is dharmas, mindfulness of dharmas, the nature of reality, yeah, the how things are. We looked at both the state of mind that perceives clearly. So this lovely image of the natural state of the mind being like clear water, it's undistorted. And then we also looked at what can disturb the mind, the different ways it can be disturbed, with the silt of confusion, or the algae of a sort of lethargy, yeah, or the dye of sense, desire, or craving. So there's also this sense of the disturbed mind. The disturbances arise and pass away. They're not part of the state of mind. Yeah. So we're not working to make the mind clear. It already is. What we're working to do is to remove the disturbances which don't need to be there. And Maitridevi also brought in this sense that actually if we bring in a dharmic perspective, if we bring in the reflections on how things are, in other words, that they are constantly changing, ungraspable or insubstantial, and unsatisfactory, if we bring that in, that can also clarify the mind. So the clear mind can see how things are, and to see and to remind yourself how things are, to bring in that perspective, can clear the mind. But the mind and heart are not separate. So whilst the mind becomes purified to this clear quality like water, clear awareness, the heart also purifies. And maybe the image for the purified heart is a bit different. Perhaps we could say that the purified heart radiates. It has this boundless radiance. So love, appreciation, gratitude, are all going to arise at the same time as the as we practice awareness, because it both purifies the mind and the heart, the heart mind. They go together, and this also means that awareness has an ethical dimension, because ethics are underpinned by love. Yeah, ethics and the precepts are guidelines for how to act in the world with love. So ethics are ethical action is intrinsic to practice of awareness. So I just want to say a little bit about structure, about the structure of these four foundations, because having looked at them, I think it's quite easy to for us still to take them literally, and we put things into boxes, and then we start getting worried about, well, is this really Vedana, or what if I was looking for Vedana but a thought came in, or you know, what if I'm trying to feel into my body but then I get caught by an emotion? And we feel like we need to separate things out in a slightly rigid way, like we have to stick within particular boxes. But the point of any structure is to allow and to invite us into experiencing things more fully. So it's structures are about inviting a certain sort of playfulness, yeah? A questioning, is it like that, isn't it? Ah, I can see these two things seem separate, ah, but then they seem to come together. So we're not working with absolute distinctions, yeah? And it's important that we don't get stuck within, create an oppression for ourselves out of a structure, yeah? So if you find yourself trying to fit your experience into boxes with labels on, just let go. Just come back and be a bit more playful. And the other thing that we have with structure is how we've been following it is in the progression, it tends to be laid out in a particular order: body, Vedana, Chitta, Dharmas. There's an order. So you can immediately feel that it is progressive. But it doesn't have to be seen as being progressive. If you find that helpful, if that makes a sort of intuitive sense to you, if that agrees with your experience, then run with that. But for other people, it doesn't work in that order. And for many people, maybe a sense of order, they think more in terms of a mandala, or of an opening and different possibilities and different directions. So again, take it lightly, experiment a bit, see what makes sense to you. But whichever way that you explore mindfulness, whether you come in through the body or through emotions or through wisdom, there's always the opportunity to experience it, your experiences in quite a gross way. There's quite a gross aspect of experience, and it can become more subtle. And as it becomes more subtle, these distinctions between body, Vedana, emotion, thought, Dharma, it tends to be harder to separate them in any meaningful way. So the more subtle experience becomes, the less these distinctions mean anything. So it all comes together. Things come together. So in his book on the Satipatthana, Anālio summarizes his take on the essence of what the four foundations of mindfulness are. He comes up with a little slogan, which is, keep calmly knowing change. Keep calmly knowing change. The calm bit, he's referring to this purified mind that is like clear water, the way the disturbances can gradually disappear and we're left with the calm mind that can see clearly. And then the knowing change bit is the way the calm mind can know what's present and also the nature of it. And the nature of it is that it's change, yeah? But the first word, keep calmly knowing change, he's talking about the way in which mindfulness or awareness requires a sort of diligence, a continuity. As I said earlier, it's something that you are rather than something that you do occasionally. So what we're trying to do is move from little bursts of mindfulness with a lot of gaps in between to an ongoing flow of mindfulness or awareness. And that requires a certain sort of effort. But the effort is mindfulness, or mindfulness and effort are synonymous. In other words, the effort, see how we tend to think of effort is often somewhat driven and pushing or forced. But we're talking about here the effort to not grasp, yeah, to not reject, to not ignore, which is to say the effort of honesty or clarity, stillness or discernment. The effort of a creative mind, which is a very open, gentle, sensitive effort. Yeah. In a way, simply being present, this sense of presence is the effort. And if we make this effort, in other words, if we simply bring ourselves present consistently, then the benefits can be huge. We can free ourselves from painful habits just by bringing awareness into our experience. We can release ourselves from being enthralled to stories or narratives that diminish us. We can become more alive and present. We show up to life more and more. And we cause less harm to self and to world. And we stop limiting ourselves. We stop limiting others. And there can be, we can live with a deep sense of interconnection, yeah, connectedness with all life. And we can recognize that this life is fleeting and it's precious. And if with awareness, with mindfulness, we can make sure we live this precious life according to our deepest values. So it offers us the possibility of living a life fully, without regret. And I just want to finish with a little quote from the Buddha. He's talking about the person who has developed mindfulness well and deeply. And what he says is, that person illuminates the world like the full moon freed from cloud. That person illuminates the world like the full moon freed from cloud. So may we practice, may we illuminate the world.